Hello, Grass Beyonders, and welcome to another episode of Anthony's Asylum. I am your host, Anthony. And, we have an interesting episode today. This episode, I wanted to talk about the recent Mad Max movie, Mad Max Fury Road, and how that film has effectively changed, in my opinion anyway, the idea of the summer blockbuster. So I wanted to talk about that. And then I wanted to get into Apple and iOS 9. So that just released this week. And for those of you who are able to, I'm sure you have updated your phone or your iPad or your, well, I guess that's about it, to iOS 9. And I just want to talk about all the new stuff that you can expect with that. And of course, I've probably already seen really cool stuff now that iOS 9 is around. It's just amazing the improvements that are made constantly. But anyway, it's going to be a short and sweet episode, hopefully. I don't know. Maybe. All right, here we go. So, Mad Max Fury Road. Really, really, really good movie. I unfortunately missed it when it was in theaters. I wanted to see it. I mean, everything I saw of it was great. You know, I read some great reviews. It had a, or still has a, 97% on Rotten Tomatoes. So fresh. And yeah, but the thing is, here's the thing, right? I am not a Mad Max fan, all right? So I just want to start out by saying that. And for those of you who are, I do apologize. It was always my intention to get into the Mad Max movies, but I just never did for whatever reason. And so I've never seen the first one. I've never seen the second one. First one is just titled Mad Max. Second one is Mad Max The Road Warrior, or sometimes simply just called The Road Warrior. Then there is a third one called Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome, and now I do remember seeing that one. I actually saw that one when I was a kid. I believe it was on TV or something. That one was on a lot, actually, like TNT, TBS, those types of channels. They would just rerun. It seemed like they reran that movie a bunch of times. I don't know. But never the first two. But I do remember Beyond Thunderdome. Specifically, what's her face? God, I can't even think of her name right now. Tina Turner. There we go. Tina Turner, man. And then she had like a really crazy song in that one too. Like, what was it called? Like Hero or something Hero. I don't know. She doesn't need another hero. Something like that. But anyway, so, you know, the Mad Max films are written and directed, largely written and directed by, I say largely because he has co-writers and things like that, but George Miller is the mastermind, I guess if you want to say that, of the Mad Max franchise. And he has directed all of them, pretty much. And, yeah, I mean, he's an Australian director. The films are set in Australia, in the outback, in a post-apocalyptic wasteland of Australia, you know. And it follows this guy called Max, who may or may not be mad, who his family has been basically taken away and killed, and you know, by this crazy, relentless gang of you know, evil people, and you know, they take everything from him, and so he decides to go on this revenge rampage, taking them down and that kind of thing. And, you know, has this cool car, the Interceptor, that he drives around the Australian outback, taking down these dudes and whatever. And that's essentially the premise, you know, the first movie, essentially the premise of the second movie as well. And the third movie as well. But the third movie adds, you know, these different elements. You know, there's this place called Thunderdome, and you have to, it's kind of this gladiatorial, you know, arena, you know, like everyone's just killing each other for sport and that kind of thing. And Tina Turner's character is the one who kind of runs this place. And I remember there being children and things like that, and he had to free some kids, I don't know, slaves or whatever. It was, like I said, I'm not a fan of Mad Max, and I can say that, sorry, you know, honestly, but, you know, I'm just not a fan. But anyway, my point is that my first real foray into the Mad Max universe is Mad Max Fury Road, which just came out in May of this year. And unfortunately I missed it because, you know, I was kind of wanting to see it, but at that time I was like, you know, I could probably wait for the DVD or the Blu-ray or whatever. But I was hearing so many good things about it that I was like, oh man, I gotta see this, but I just never had the chance. And so this last weekend I just picked it up on Redbox. And it was on Blu-ray, and I was like, okay, great, I'm gonna watch it, and, yeah, I was just blown away by it. And this is, when you start thinking about, you're going into the history of where these films came from, and especially the director, George Miller, it's interesting, it's almost, there are parallels there, you know, where Mad Max sort of took a really long break, because actually Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome came out in 1985, I believe. And so now we have a new Mad Max movie, which is 30 years later. Wow, that's freaking insane. Now I feel really old. But yeah, so 30 years. And when you think about George Miller and his career, you know, take a look at his IMDb page. The last real big thing he did was, in fact, Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome. And he had some kind of, you know, successful movies after that. He did The Witches of Eastwick and Lorenzo's Oil. And then he had kind of a break and then came back to do Babe, Pig in the City. If any of you remember that movie, I actually really enjoyed that movie. I thought, in fact, it was superior to the first one. I know the first one is beloved by many people, but I do like Pig in the City. And another big famous movie he's really known for, at least around parents, I think, and kids, is Happy Feet. And he also did Happy Feet 2. And this was all in a span of roughly, what, 10, 13 years. So Babe, Pig in the City came out in 1998. Then huge break. Then in 2006, he did Happy Feet, and then in 2011, he did Happy Feet 2. So, you know, you could say he just kind of went the family film route at that point and just maybe gave up on action movies or gave up on, you know, or whatever. I don't know what his reasoning was. Who knows? I haven't really gotten into that. And then, of course, 2015, boom, you know, Mad Max Fury Road. And, of course, you know, I'd heard about this movie last year, and I think there were some rumblings. There's always been rumblings, you know, some rumors of like, oh, when's the next version of this coming out, you know. And, you know, one of the fears, I think, when you talk about a franchise like that is that, you know, if it falls into the wrong hands, you know, if there's filmmakers who don't really care or know much about the source material and take it upon themselves, or even worse yet, studios and executive producers and Hollywood people, as it were, just trying to cash in, you know, trying to find, ooh, the next big project that we can reboot or remake or you know, whatever. And, you know, when I heard about Mad Max, I was kind of worried about that. You know, they were throwing it around as, oh, remake, reboot this and all that. And I think one of the things that kind of put me at ease at that point was, oh, George Miller is coming back to do it, even though, like I said, I'd never seen the other films, and I liked the idea of the original creator coming back and, you know, doing justice at least to his series that he created, you know, that he made famous. I always like to see that kind of stuff. So, and that was, like I said, good. And but then there was sort of rumblings. There started to be rumblings of, oh, reboot and this kind of thing. And you know, originally they wanted to get Mel Gibson back. And the funny thing is, sorry, just to kind of backtrack a little bit, the film came out this year, Right, 2015. But George Miller, according to him, was already planning on doing another Mad Max film all the way back in 2003. And at that point, it was largely going to be a sequel to Beyond Thunderdome. So it was going to have Mel Gibson and that kind of thing and kind of continue that story. But unfortunately, Mel Gibson, or maybe fortunately, I mean, depending on how you want to see it, but he went through all that kind of crap. Well, he made The Passion of the Christ, so he was largely making his own movies. He was less in movies, I guess, and sort of behind the camera. And then, of course, he went through all the stuff with his family and the anti-Semitic stuff and the DUI and all that. So, you know, I think they were trying to create distance. And the interesting thing to me, though, is once they realized where they were going to go with the franchise, and then they cast Tom Hardy, who is excellent, by the way, as Mad Max. Tom Hardy actually went and had lunch with Mel Gibson to ask for his blessing, essentially, which I thought was kind of cool. And of course, Mel Gibson said, yes, you know, it's great. You know, I was worried that, like, oh man, how is this going to work out? And then you hear this report like, oh, Mel Gibson punched out Tom Hardy at a restaurant. You know, I don't know, but no, it actually ended up, you know, they were both amiable about it. And, it turned out well. And so now we have Mad Max Fury Road, which I know there's differing opinions. There is the opinion that it is a reboot in the sense that, well, I guess you can call it a reboot. I mean, it is a reboot of the franchise, right? It's not an origin story, though. It's not completely taking you back to the beginning and telling you how Max became mad, you know what I mean? And I'm glad they didn't do that. So in the way I saw it, like I said, not remembering Beyond Thunderdome and not having seen the first two movies, when I popped this one in, it started out pretty simply. I mean, it started out with Max overlooking, you know, the wasteland next to his car, and then it has a little bit of narration, and he's talking about, you know, he lives on his own, and he's a loner, and he's out just, you know, trying to survive. You know, he's a survivor. And that's really all you need, you know what I mean? You don't need... But the interesting thing is that there is some really cool moments. I mean, he is definitely mad. I mean, it's such an appropriate title, because throughout the film, he is experiencing hallucinations, visions from the past, that kind of thing, that kind of give you an idea of where he's come from, what he's suffered through. And Tom Hardy does such an amazing job in that movie. But Mad Max Fury Road, let's get into that finally, is essentially about Mad Max, right? Played by Tom Hardy. Surviving in the wilderness. I mean, you're following him, you know, his misadventures. He gets, kidnapped at one point. He gets tortured. All this stuff is going on. And meanwhile, you have this other story, this land, this place, with this huge dude. You know, his name is Immortan Joe, who rules these people with an iron fist, and he's got this crazy breathing apparatus, kind of like Darth Vader. And he's got many wives, you know, and all this stuff. And he controls water. You know, this is the precious commodity in this community, is water. And everybody wants water, and they worship the water, and they worship this man who controls the water, you know. And anyway, so this is an amazing setup. And then you have Imperator Furiosa, played by Charlize Theron, an excellent Charlize Theron, in a role that is not typical of her, obviously, but very strong and very cool, you know what I mean? Like, she's just, like, kick-ass and whatever. And yeah, and so anyway, Immortan Joe sends her out with his war rig to essentially, as a message to these other clans, because I guess there are other people out there, other, you know, tribes and cities that, you know, are trying to do whatever they can to remain on top in this crazy place, in this crazy wasteland. And so he sends her out, and she's leaving with the war rig and a bunch of other dudes, and thinking this is going to be a raiding party or whatever the heck they're doing. And then you find out, oh wait, Furiosa is actually intent on betraying Immortan Joe, and she's got his wives in tow. So she's basically trying to free them and get them out, and they're trying to make it to this place called the Green Place, which is a place that Furiosa has grown up in and that kind of thing. And so she remembers it fondly, and she was actually kidnapped by, they don't really say, I don't know if it was Immortan Joe who kidnapped her, or, you know, the people that Immortan Joe rules over or whatever. But anyway, so this starts this huge chase, and Mad Max is a prisoner, of course, in this camp, in this place, and they take him out and they use him as a freaking hood ornament on one of their cars to chase down the war rig and all this stuff. I mean, it's crazy. I mean, the whole movie is just one big, massive, epic car chase. Like, just imagine that for a second. This isn't just, these aren't people going from point A to point B, taking a break. You know what I mean? Like, I'm trying to find the words to describe it. It's very hard, but first and foremost, Mad Max Fury Road is very visual. There is little to no dialogue, which I think is just fascinating, especially for a summer blockbuster. I mean, I think we're so used to having so many stories these days handed to us, you know what I mean, like on a silver platter, like just here you go, here's the story, guys, this is, you know, we have everything for you here, this is the nice little beginning here in the middle where all the stuff happens, the conflict and stuff, and then we have a nice tidy bow at the end that will wrap it all up nicely for you, you know what I mean. And Mad Max does not do that. Fury Road does not do that. It's and I've seen a lot of comments, honestly, from people saying the movie is just dumb or boring or doesn't have a story or this kind of thing. And it's just, it's BS, quite frankly. I'm sorry, but it has a fantastic story. Just because it's not spelled out to you, just because it's not spoken on-the-nose dialogue, you know what I mean, that most movies have these days. And, you know, I don't mean to criticize some of the really good movies that come out. I really enjoyed Avengers Age of Ultron, for instance, because I think Joss Whedon, you know, does a really great job at weaving a story. So, you know, he's always got a lot of dialogue in his movies, but they're never, it's never dialogue that is on the nose or unwanted or something, you know what I mean? It never really truly spells out, you know, in a really stupid way. But Mad Max Fury Road is just a completely different beast. Like I said, it's very different from a traditional summer blockbuster, in the sense that, well, first of all, everybody that you're watching on screen is mad, quite frankly. You're following these people around that are not completely sane. And, you know, you'd think that's one of the things that would happen. I mean, if you're living in a post-apocalyptic world, I mean, nobody's going to be okay. You're not going to be okay. I would argue that now people are not okay, but that's a different story. But yeah, so it's just, the visuals are just amazing. The cinematography is fantastic. What George Miller did was to differentiate it from other post-apocalyptic movies. I mean, when you think about post-apocalyptic, you're thinking desaturated. You're thinking muted tones, you're thinking, you know, very dark, drab, you're thinking, you know, all these things, and that makes sense. But this movie, oh God, it's so colorful, it's so rich with color and flavor, and you feel every, you know, bead of sweat coming off people's foreheads, and you know, and the blood dripping, and the, you know, it's such a rich red, and the deserts are such a rich orange, and you know, there's even some greenery, and there's, you know, I mean, it's just the variety of environments that you see. And like I said, this is a chase movie that is, you know, the whole way through, which, like I said, sounds crazy, but just take my word for it and watch it, because you will be pleasantly surprised. And Max, of course, is inadvertently forced into this. You know, like I said, he starts out as a hood ornament on one of these dudes' cars who's chasing, you know, Furiosa and Immortan Joe's wives. And, you know, all this crap starts happening. And, eventually Max, you know, gets freed and, you know, decides to help Furiosa in her cause, you know, but it's definitely not an easy journey and not an easy decision for him to make. But I think the fact that he makes it and that you start seeing his evolution as a character, you know, because at the beginning he's very much just, you know, it's him or the highway. It's about his survival. You know, everyone else he can just sacrifice because he has lost so much, you know. And, but the fact that he kind of regains that and becomes human again, it's so well done. Like I said, without dialogue, without cheesy lines or without, you know, just any of that usual sort of summer blockbuster action movie cheese, you know what I mean? And it's so well done. So like I said, Mad Max Fury Road. If you haven't seen it, go see it. I am now a fan of Mad Max, and I will go back and watch the first and second one if I can. I know that Beyond Thunderdome is on Hulu right now, so I will definitely rewatch that one. I'm pretty sure the first and second one are on Vudu, so I'll see about maybe renting those, but yeah. Totally. If you have not seen Fury Road, that is actually probably a good place to start. You don't necessarily need to see the earlier films, at least from what I understand. And I totally got what was going on when I saw Fury Road. But it is an adrenaline-filled, beautiful ride, quite frankly. And that's something, and again, something when you're talking about a post-apocalyptic world, you're not thinking, oh, beautiful, but it is just a wonder to behold. I mean, every shot in that movie, I was just in awe. And it's a movie that, you know, quite frankly, made me excited about films again. It made me excited about filmmaking. It made me excited about, you know, it inspired me to, like, kind of think about, hey, this is cool. I mean, look at what this guy did. And George Miller, I mean, he's 70 years old. So, I mean, if he can do that, then damn, you know. But I would say, you know, George Miller is effectively back to the action movie. And let's see what he'll come up with next. All right, now I want to talk about iOS 9 and the new improvements that have been made. So the update came out just this week. But yeah, iOS 9, they were saying, oh, it's going to work with everything from iPhone 4S to, you know, all the way up to obviously the newest phones, and then iPad mini first gen all the way up to, you know, iPad mini 4 or whatever. So I was like, oh, cool, awesome, so I will get those. But of course, those updates were freaking huge. I think they were like 1.5 gigs. And I don't have that much space on my phone left or my iPad. So it was interesting trying to figure out what to get rid of and what to keep and that kind of thing. But anyway, iOS 9, right? Huge. Really big update. And it seems like these past couple of years, they've been really just improving a lot over the course of a year. I mean, I haven't really been expecting that much, but every year they've just been delivering really good stuff. Like, take for instance iOS 6 to iOS 7, huge. And really the biggest thing with that one was the big visual overhaul, you know, making everything sort of a simplified UI, and then going from iOS 7 to iOS 8, which was essentially refining iOS 8 a little bit more, but adding some cool features as well. But now going from iOS 8 to iOS 9, I don't know, to me it's like really big. Like, it was jarring to me. I had no idea they had changed the font. Like, I don't know if you have already updated to iOS 9 on your device, but if you have, that's got to be something that had got your attention right away, because that got my attention right away. I had no idea they changed the font at all, but apparently the font is different. And it's taking some time for me to get used to it, honestly. Like, I like it, but I'm also like, wow. Like, every time I see it, every time I see the time, you know, if I turn my phone on really quick just to, or turn the screen on really quick just to see the time or whatever, I'm always like, what happened to my font? But it is a nice font, and it just takes getting used to it. I think now I'm kind of getting used to it. I've been using iOS 9 now for, you know, a few days, not very long, but it is a nice font. It's just different enough to where it kind of gets your attention, or at least it did me. And I'm a big kind of, I like fonts and I like design and that kind of thing. So maybe it struck me more because of that, but I don't know. Like, for me, it just kind of was a bit jarring. And then, of course, we have some new built-in apps. And I know some people dislike the built-in apps. I am on the fence about it. There are some apps I don't like, and there are some apps I do like. Like, I don't like, for instance, the Watch OS app, or the Watch app, or whatever, because I don't have a watch. I don't have an Apple Watch. So I should be able to delete it until I get an Apple Watch, for instance, or the Stocks app, for instance, or the, you know, what's the other one? There's some other ones. I do like the Compass one. I think that's cool. The Compass and the Level, that's really cool. But yeah, some of them are just like, eh, really? And then Notes, that was the other one too. I didn't really like Notes that much. But, so we have some new apps. And these apps, I think, are actually worth keeping. So the first one that they have that they released is called News, and I'm like, yes, finally they have a dedicated news app that is gonna basically get news from all these sources, which is exactly what I want in a news app. You know, I you know, for a while I was using CNN, I was using BBC, you know, all these different news things, and then I got rid of those because I was just like, oh god, it's so dumb, like, because you're only getting certain types of news. And then you really have to dig through the app to really get what you want. So the one I've actually been recently using before this new news app, and I know a lot of people use Flipboard and those types of things, and, you know, I just never got into those anyway, or BuzzFeed or whatever. But I got into Yahoo News Digest. That was my news reader, and still is, actually, quite frankly. Even though this new news app is pretty good, I'm still, my go-to is still the Yahoo News Digest on both my iPhone and my iPad, because it's just great. I love it. And it's a quick way to get a lot of news in a very short amount of time and space. And if you want to expand and read more, you can, which I love, but I don't always have time to do that. But the new news app is just really well designed. So yeah, that's built in. That's, you know, like I said, it starts you out with getting an idea of what you like. So it says, you know, choose what kind of news you want to read. So you're clicking on all these tiles. You're like, okay, I want to read this, 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 this. And then it combines it. And so every time you go in, you know, it'll generate stories and articles from around the world to this news app. And it's pretty amazing. And you can always add stuff. You can always delete stuff. So it's pretty cool. And I'm playing around with it now. I haven't really delved into it too much, but so that's one of the new ones. The other one is Notes has been greatly updated, actually. I actually may start using Notes now, because I just, ever since they introduced Notes, I think, what was it, iOS 6 maybe or something, I don't know, they've had it for a while, but I just, oh god, it was so simplistic and so, like, dull to me that I just never got into it. And I have always been using Evernote, and that's my go-to Notes app, is Evernote, and still is. But I don't know, this new Notes might get me using it more. You know, they've added some cool stuff, such as they added, like, the ability to, you know, if you're in some other app like Safari or Maps or Pages or whatever, you can actually hit the share button of whatever app you're in, and the Notes icon will appear in there, and you can just stick it in a note. So that, to me, is cool. You can also turn lists into checklists now, which I guess you couldn't do. Of course, that's been something on Evernote that I've been using for a while. And then you can also sketch stuff now. You can actually draw stuff with your finger, or if you have a stylus or whatever, right into the Notes app, which is cool. And you can also take photos and that kind of thing. So a lot of people who are familiar with Evernote will be familiar with these changes, because it's basically, now it's like Evernote. It's Evernote Lite, really. It's still not quite Evernote, but like I said, I might give it a try now. And then, of course, we have Maps. And Maps has been greatly enhanced and improved as well. And the other thing too is you can actually see what's nearby now. So if you're driving somewhere, it's all in app. So if you have an address that you type in directions to here or whatever, it'll give you all these suggestions, like, you know, what food is nearby, what, you know, anything, you know, event, whatever, you know, museums, whatever, and just anything you're looking for, shopping, you know, transportation, anything, movies, whatever, theaters, all kinds of stuff. So that is a really cool feature. And then, of course, Passbook. I don't know if you guys remember Passbook, but Passbook has been renamed Wallet. And I guess that's where you keep all your stuff now with Apple Pay and tickets and all that. I never really used it, and I don't have an iPhone 6 or a 6S yet. So Apple Pay to me is doesn't really work. So this would be one of the apps that I would like to delete for now, but can't, unfortunately. And now iCloud Drive is its own app as well. So it's on your home screen now. And, you know, essentially does what it did before. Still, in my opinion, kind of limited in terms of, I wish that Apple would just freaking up the iCloud Drive capacity. Like, God, like, why does it have to be 5 gigs? Like, are you kidding me? There's so many services out there that give you 15 gigs, 20 gigs for free, you know what I mean, to start out, and then up there, and then they just kind of incrementally go up. So I don't know, I'm kind of like, well, come on, 5 gigs. they should definitely up that. And then the big update for me anyway, I haven't tested it yet on my iPad, but is the whole, like, split view is what they're calling it. And picture in picture and all that kind of stuff, you know, that, oh, okay, you know, I know all the Samsung fanboys and fangirls are saying, oh, well, we could do that ever since, you know, 2008 or what, you know, I don't care, whatever. But now Apple has introduced that with iOS 9, you know, so you get this, you know, picture in picture, slide over, split view, whatever you want to call it, on your iPad. So you can do actual multitasking, which, you know, is kind of cool. But I, like I said, I don't know if you can use it on the iPad mini first generation. Probably not, because the chip and the CPU are not up to par to probably do that, but I will definitely test around to see if that does work. And then, of course, Siri, you know, the next big thing here, I guess, is they talk about Siri and being more predictive, which is kind of following in the footsteps of OK Google and that kind of thing, which, you know, arguably Google has always been better at than any other company anyway, because think about it. What does Google do? They gather data. They gather information. That is their purpose. That was their purpose to begin with. And so they better have a good foundation. You know what I mean? And so now Apple is getting into that, which is good. But at the same time, you know, now that Siri is more predictive, she's a little bit smarter. I still think she's kind of dumb, in my opinion. You know, the issue now, I think, is talking about privacy and that kind of thing. You know, like, you know, you hear about these things like Amazon Echo or even, you know, Google, OK Google, all that kind of stuff, you know, or even Microsoft's Cortana. All these things, I mean, are they listening all the time? I mean, what's the deal here? I know that for a fact, Amazon Echo, that listens all the time, which is kind of scary. And, you know, it's designed to listen for you all the time so that it can predict what you want and get you what you want, you know what I mean? Which is cool. But at the same time, you know, where's that information going? You know, like I said, Google, you know, and these other companies, Apple, Amazon, they're quickly becoming data gatherers, you know what I mean? So, you know, just something to think about, you know, just like think about your privacy policy, guys, and maybe we don't need intelligent assistants or whatever the heck you want to call them. But like I said, I don't know, she's a little bit smarter, so you can say things that are more vague now. Like, for instance, on their website here, it shows that you can say, show me photos from Utah last August, for instance, or you can say, remind me about this when I get in the car. So I guess it's going to know when you get in your car, and then it's going to remind you about something, which, I don't know. Like I said, I want to test those kinds of things out, but, you know, who knows? So everything, like I said, is more grouped together. It's a little bit more, she's more proactive, or he, if you want to do a male voice. So everything is kind of more like Siri should have been from the beginning, I guess. But still not, like, perfect. You know, nowhere near perfect. I think that's going to take a lot more than just a single iOS update. And then the last thing that they try and tout here is that the new update really saves on battery life. And I have not really seen that yet. Like I said, I'm still rocking an iPhone 5. And I've got the iPad mini first generation. So, you know, those are pretty old devices when you think about devices. You know what I mean? I mean, what the iPhone 5 is now, what, 3, 4 years? 4 years old? Nah, 3 years old. So old when you're talking about, you know, tech, but relatively new when you're talking about, oh, this, you know, this is a cool product that I just got and it was expensive and, you know, I plan to keep it forever and that kind of thing. But yeah, I mean, in the tech world, it's pretty old. And the iPad mini, I think, came out. Actually, I think it came out at the same time. Did it come out the iPhone 5 or was it the 5S? I don't know. But anyway, so a couple years, 3 years, something like that. But I guess they're touting this whole, oh, you're going to have longer battery life. And, you know, they've developed some kind of tech that will kind of trim battery life, make it more efficient. You know, one of the things they're doing is also they have a low power mode now, which I haven't really used either. It's interesting. I went into the settings just to kind of see if they had something like that, because they actually have their own. It has iOS 9 has its own dedicated battery section now under settings. So you go to settings and then it'll just say battery and you just click on battery and then it'll have all these different things you can do. And if you hit low power, it's interesting because it'll give you this little indicator at the top and your bar turns yellow. And I don't know, to me, it just kind of freaks me out. But and there's no like background app refresh. There's no notifications. There's all these different things that you can do to, you know, to extend your battery life. So I don't know, again, very interesting. But of course, you know, people who have been using Android devices will say that, oh, we already had that. So, but that's fine. I don't care. Whatever. And apparently it's just supposed to make everything faster and more responsive and you've got improved security. So now what they're doing, instead of they used to do 4-digit passcodes, now they're doing 6-digit passcodes. Plus they're doing the 2-point or the 2-factor authentication. So I don't know. And hey, for all you Android lovers out there or Android haters, whatever it is, if you want to move over to an iPhone, which I recommend, you can get the handy Move to iOS app, which is available at your whatever Google App Store, wherever the hell you guys go. And yeah, and you can just migrate all your stuff over when you get your iPhone. So pretty cool. But anyway, that's iOS 9, guys. So guys, thank you so much for listening to another episode of Anthony's Asylum. I am your host, Anthony. Anthony's Asylum releases every Friday, for the most part. I always have to say that because I may get sick or something or whatever. I don't know. But hopefully I don't. But anyway, yes, every Friday, guys. Every Friday. And it releases on YouTube, SoundCloud, iTunes, and my Patreon page. And my Patreon page is pretty important to me because it's just a really cool place you can go if you want to support artists in a more sort of traditional, classical way, I guess. You know, it's a way to commission people if you want, you know what I mean? But the cool thing about it is, you know, you set what you want to pay to donate to whatever artist you know, want to see their work, you know, more of their work, that kind of thing. And so I have that and it's pretty cool, and it's not for the podcast. The podcast is going to be free for as long as I keep doing it, but it is a way to help me do the other things that I love to do, you know, the filmmaking stuff, all that kind of stuff, short films, documentary, everything that I like to do that requires a lot more money than I have, quite frankly. So, but it'd be cool. Just so if you could check that out and think about supporting me, that would be awesome. But anyway, thanks again, guys, for listening, and I will see you, or rather talk to you, next time.